Okay, so have a look with me to see our next example. So now we're going to compare with some data. So let's just, and I have this usual fly. So here on ITB, put on your seatbelts just to go for context, right? So you know geography, because I know we always have to go to North America, but so there's North Pacific, and then I have this KMZ at this place called Point Arena. So it's a coastal location in California. And here is a piece of LiDAR data of the coast, hill shape. And so if I turn it off, you can see this is the ocean and this is a road here. And it's a little slow to load the imagery, but I computed this hill shape before. So what you can see is there's the modern cliff edge of the ocean, and then this line right here is the Marine Terrace edge. Okay? So this Marine Terrace edge, I took a profile from right in here. So now let me go to ARC. So I gave you this MXT file. Actually, this is a 10.1, so I'll have to update if you guys want to 9.3 and 10.0 after. Or you can just do it yourself. The Point Arena IMG is what all you really need. So here you can see the places, the profiles, and so I made a few. Let's delete this one. This one. So just remember this one, because this is a good one that we'll use. But you can experiment. So if we cut some profiles, let's just look at the original one. This is the modern one. So this would be an analog. When we do this diffusion modeling, what does it look like at the beginning, at time zero? Ooh, sorry, that's because it was on the... Well, I thought it was on the ocean there, but let's try it again. Ah, that's better. So this is the modern terrace edge. So you see the height, it's about, you know, 45, 50 meters tall. It's quite steep at the top. Has a little bit of already some gluvium accumulating maybe. So now we can do another one over here and check. Pretty steep, right? About 50 meters tall. This one, 5,000. I must be going off, you know, there must be some holes in the model because there's not LiDAR returns from the ocean surface everywhere. So sometimes when I hit a hole, I bet I cause a problem. There. So there's another terrace riser. So these are important because what we assume, we're going to do substitution of space for time. So we're going to say that this is zero, time zero, and this over here is some future time, or some later time. And so the idea would be that this is what it looks like at the beginning, and then this is what it's going to look like after some amount of time. And so, because ARC doesn't do a great job of dealing with vertical exaggeration, this looks pretty steep also, but I think if we compared it with the active ones, it wouldn't be quite as steep, and it's certainly a little bit more rounded. The other thing is it's pretty symmetric, this one, which is good for our modeling that we're going to do in a moment. So let me clean a little bit, check a few more. So one thing you can see, notice I'm only taking it from places where there's no river channel, because the diffusion only works on non-fluvial parts of the landscape. It's just a hill slope process. So, for example, if I go up this channel, I'm going to see a very different profile. And we could exploit this if we wanted to, but the rules for how fluvial systems evolve are much more complex than the hill slopes. And so that's one reason. Oh, there's a hole in there. Let's try that again. the diffusion is really simple mathematically, so. Let me zoom in and see if I can avoid the hole. See, I must be hitting some bad. Oh, it's the slope. I see where it is. You see, God, you saw it. It's right. See right here, these little things there, those are holes in the data from the LiDAR. There's no return, so you go around. So this is the fluvial channel profile. So it actually has a pretty good nick point in it right here. And so the analysis of nick points is something that we can do using fluvial rules, but its application for dating, like this morphologic dating that we're doing with the diffusion, isn't as established. So we probably would only look at it, but not really model it. Because for example, the Ks, the transport rates for the fluvial system are not as well calibrated as they are for the diffusion. So, that is that. So let's zoom that out. Okay, so now let's look at a few of these profiles. This terrace, this old one, there's one there. You see it's pretty smooth. Be careful not to hit these bushes. Okay, so this is what we're dealing with. Just these steps in the landscape and how they change. So what we did is we have this piece of software that we call Scarp Dater. And one of my former students, he wrote it, this guy, Hilly, Lord Hilly, is a now famous professor, not necessarily because of my contributions. He's a very smart guy. And so if I just push run, so here's how this program works, is we can import a file. So what I did, if I go back to here, if I take this longitudinal profile, or this topographic profile, and I click here and here, and I make the profile, I can right-click, export, and I can export the data. And if I don't include the header and point labels, I just have X, Y. So let me save this. I already did it there, but I'll just call it an arena 2. So close, let's go look at it. So there they are. So this is ARC. It does a really good job of just spitting out the total profile, X versus Z. So distance versus elevation, right? And so now we go to our program, to Scarp Dater. What I can do is import the XZ profile. And I need to change this, and actually, okay, I have it inside this Queen Arena 1 that I did before my practice. The same as Queen Arena 2. So there it is, I've loaded it. But the one thing about our program, it's very simple, well, George's program, although I wrote a part of it, what we want to do is we want to try to do a calculation to find the best fitting model profile. So what I can do is I have to set it up. So the first thing I do is flip it because it only likes to go down to the right. So now what I can do is, so A is 10, but I need to also tell the program where the middle of the scarp is. So if I do like that. Okay, and then I have to experiment and say, well, what is the initial offset? So, remember, this is a marine terrace, not a fault, but it's basically the same thing. It's some feature that formed fairly, fairly quickly. So an A is just a half height of the feature. So 20 meters is not high enough. So if I go, let's say, 15. So you see those two guys, but they're asymmetric. So I can center it. I need to pull it down a little. So it's not too bad. But actually, the if you look, you see how this has a little bit of a slope to it there, and so does this. So that's the, we call it the far-field slope. So that's the B angle. It's not zero. It has a little bit of slope. So let's try B as 1. So that looks like it's a little bit better, right? Except now 15 is too much. So let me try 14. Ah, pretty good, right? So the main thing with these diffusion models is it's not so smart. So it really needs you to help it find the middle so that it can balance what's going to be eroded from here and deposited there. So the initial shape is going to go from here to here. Okay? So we just have to remember, so it's also not very smart. So just remember A is 14 and B is 1. Okay, so now I close this. And it remembers the center, but so now I'm going to calculate my fit. And so what I do is I do, like our Excel, it uses the same exact math, but it does it many times, and it compares the calculation with the observed, and it computes the error. And so it just is going to help us find the best fit. So the morphologic age, the KT, I know we need to probably go to about 500. And if I do it 51 times, that'll be basically sort of increment by 10. And the fan slope, even though I know it's 1, it'll still test. It's gonna explore a bunch of shapes just to make sure. But I know this A is 14. And then theta is the initial slope. How steep is it once it forms? So I'll say it's 45 degrees. You could do higher, but maybe 45 is reasonable. And this horizontal offset, this is a little bit of a confusing because it's not fault offset. It's just the program is still going to move the profile up and down as we were centering to double check that we're exactly centered. And this just helps it kind of get close. So let's run it then. So it's sweeping through, it does a lot of calculations. So it says the best KT is 352. And it needed to move the whole thing down by 2.4 meters to get the best fit. And it said, remember I said B was 1, it found that the best B is actually 0.87, not the best B quote. So now let's go to, if we go to plot and we do single, let's see. Well, here's the sensitivity analysis. So this is basically error versus what it's exploring. So the main thing we care about is KT. So as it increases KT, the error is going down. Okay, and so when the error is minimum, is the best KT. And then as the KT goes up, it means we're eroding and sedimenting too much. And so that's bad. So this is how we find the optimal KT. So this program helps us find that value by it's called a grid search. It just searches through, all these directions. So, but now we can see the result here if we do the single event forward model. So I'm just gonna start here. So this is basically, this piece of the program is kind of like what the Excel was doing. So I can set this profile. How long is that profile? It's about 300. So I'll do 0 and 0. So there's a 100 meter long profile, but then here's the height is, this half height is 14. So there's our scarp and it's 45. And then we said the fan slope was 1. Okay? So that's the initial, almost, well, that's a KT of 1. So it's very low. It's not very old. But what did we say? It said 340? was the optimal KT? 343? 352. So if I do 352, that's what it thinks it looks like. Okay, so you guys ready to compare with the data? So what you have to do in this program is say hold on, that keeps this drawing on. And now if I turn this on, I can hit it. Oh, it should show the data. Oh, that's too bad. It turns out fits exactly. Let me try it again. Ah, okay, there it is. So there's the data. I don't know why it didn't show up. So now, if I do hold on, and I'll just replot the theory. There. So now, this is what the calculation was, and this is what is pretty nice about this. Let me zoom in. So here you can see, what you can see is the blue would be the initial shape of the marine terrace right after, right when the ocean goes away. And then the black would be what the computer calculated at 352 kt for the form. And then the red is the data. That's what we observe, our profile. So you can see it's pretty good fit. It's all a little under. So that means that my centering is not quite right. I probably could lift the whole thing up a little bit. But you see it's pretty good shape here and here. And so now if I say KT 352, and this is coastal California, and I want to know the age, what do I do? So K times T equals 352. So how do I figure out how old this is?
So I'll do a simple
math.
Maybe I'm not being quite so clear, but let's do it together. So what we know is K times T equals 352 meters squared. What we want is T at this time. So we can just do the simple math, right? You can say T equals 352 meters squared divided by A. So then, coastal California, what did we say on our table A was?
Remember?
Yeah. 11. Yeah. So then I just do T equals 352 meters squared over 11. And then the units of K is meters squared per 1,000 meters. Okay? So then when you do the math, you know this gets cropped out, right? So 352 over 11 equals... How many? 32. So the answer then is 32, and then this KY goes up here, right? Right. So we would say that's 32,000 meters. So, it would be nice to have an independent age control, right? And so that's where you go to test. So, what we can experiment, but now let's do some. What I want to show you is that, you know, it's probably not exactly 35,000 years old, but it's somewhere around there. So that's where this program is useful. So if I say, let's try 3,300, so 30,000 years old. So you see, we saw it's slightly less, but very small amount less. So if I do 200, okay, so 200 looks like it's not gonna work. So 20,000 years would be too young. And that was this line, the last one we added. So if I do 100 or 10,000 years, oh, that's 1,000,000 years old. So that's definitely that's 100,000 years old. It's 1,000 divided by 10, right? So 100,000 is too far. Now if I go to
If I make this 100, this would be 10,000. Also too little. So what you can see by us doing this is we can look at the, basically we're looking at the shape of this sensitivity analysis. And so what it shows is that, you know, our best fit is here, but this is a meter, so this is kind of like the average misfit. So right now our average misfit down the far is like 0.37 meters, but if you go up to maybe 0.5, this is what I usually do. Well, I'm actually 0.5 here, so that's going up to about 14. So what I would argue is that almost everything in this view is generally acceptable and would be close. But once what we proved is, once you get out less than about 200, it's not fitting. And once you get past maybe about 500, which is 20,000, 50,000, it's not fitting well. So a lot of times when we do this work, to be really fair, even though we calculate 35, it's really probably something like, so in this program,
what you do is, you just, if you turn hold off, that means it will destroy whatever we show next. So if I click, I think, on show data, that's back to only the data. Now if I, zoom in, now I'll do hold on. And so what we can say is, all right, well, here's our best model right now, 352. Okay? But now what I'm saying is you can experiment, and you say, well, what I just said is 200 on one side is that's this one here. It's a little bit not enough erosion, and maybe enough sedimentation. So 200's okay. It looks like it's on the young side. Now if I do 400, you see 400 is pretty close to 352, so it's probably still acceptable. But remember, our sensitivity analysis showed it going out like 460. So let me try 500. So now 500 is down here, and it's looking like we're starting to really erode too much. And sedimentation is okay on this side, but we're already starting to pass it. So that's what I'm saying, is that now this shows the kind of like the bounds of age.
This is 20,000, and that's 50,000. So somewhere in there. It's just like here, this is 20,000, and that's 50,000. So maybe 20,000 is a little bit too low. We could probably push it up to 25. So if I go 250. So that 250 right there.
So just like a lot of our methods, this is our relative, kind of a relative dating method. So it works well when you're near other places that are similar. So because we can then hold things like the climate. So if we go to this coastal California, you know, there's a lot of marine terraces along this coast. So we might only have to date it in one place. So then we could go all along the coast and find all the same terraces just by the morphologic comparison. And that would be probably, would work pretty well because it's the same climate. But now, if I go somewhere else, I have to assume that I can just use these values, that they're reasonable. I can choose the right one for my place. But what's best is if you calibrate locally. So you would, you know, what we would do is go to our place here at Point Arena and figure out how to date this thing somehow. You know, maybe dig a trench across the, here's our terrace rising right there. So maybe we could trench it or date the overlying material and figure out really how old it is.
And then we would do that to solve for K instead of T. And then we would have K for everywhere else, and then we can use K to solve. So you could go both directions.
Yeah, so that's a pretty key point for calibration.